to become the kind of person who trains leaders and works with teams to help them solve the biggest issues. He is now the CEO of Michael Pope Training, LLC, and has delivered hundreds of speeches and workshops helping organizations and individuals overcome their challenges, both on the computer and with the individual working the computer. Michael is a DTM and is certified at the highest level as an international John Maxwell team speaker, trainer, and coach, and serves on the marketing faculty for leadership, author, and expert John C. Maxwell. He also holds certifications in DISC Behavior Analyst, Neurocoding, and Virtual Presenting. In 2021, he received one of 10 prestigious John Maxwell Culture Awards, being selected out of 35,000 coaches in 160 countries. Please help me welcome Mr. Michael Pope.
All right. Thank you, Derek. I appreciate it. Wow. I'm truly excited to be here with you all today to really talk to you about one of my favorite subjects, which is productivity. Like many of you, right, I didn't know what was going to happen with the pandemic. I know when March 2020 came and things started shutting down left and right, for many of us, it stopped us in our tracks. But I have to tell you, I took full advantage of the pandemic, and I was actually more productive during the years of the pandemic than I was even leading up to it. And the main reason why is because some strategies that I'm going to share with you today really help open up my mind. So do me a favor real quick. So in the chat, type a one if you want to be more productive. All right, I see some ones. Absolutely. Hopefully that's why you all are here, to be more productive. And I truly believe with these strategies that I'm going to share with you today, you can definitely be more productive. And I'm going to go through a series of PowerPoint slides and all that. And just so you know, I have a PDF version of these handouts that I'm going to provide to you. So you can take some notes, but I'm still going to give you the slides as well so you can get a deeper dive into what we're going to go over. And so if you don't know me, I am a member of District 40. Been a member of District 40 for the last 14 to 15 years or so. And so let me just tell you a little idea about my background. I'm married. My wife and I will be celebrating our 25th year of marriage this coming May. We also have three amazing boys. My two oldest sons are currently working towards their second degree in black belt. My youngest is working towards his first degree in black belt. And like many of you, my household is busy, right? We have activities. We have different things we're doing. However, one of the things that really separates us is that we've learned how to be productive in every area that matters in our life. Now, I'll be completely honest with you. There are some areas of my life that are chaos, right? There's some things I just don't do. You look at my backyard right now, you'll see that, hey, he's not that productive in his backyard. Because that's just not my area of giftedness or strength. But there are areas that mean a lot to me that I choose. I made the decision a long time ago to be productive in. And so I'm going to share that with you a little bit here as we go through this. All right. That's my awesome family there. And we're talking about being productive. So just to give you an idea, 2020, 2021, and even 2022, I've had some great moments of productivity. And so I'm going to share some of the highlights with you. One of them at my job, during work, I won the award for one of the volunteers of the year in our IT department at my company. I work for International Paper full time. So that was an amazing award right there. In Toastmasters 2020-2021, I achieved this award here, Outstanding Service Award. So this is all during that pandemic time frame, right? Part of the Maxwell team, as Derek mentioned earlier, I was one of 10 recipients of the John Maxwell Culture Award. And so I achieved the one for exceeding expectations. And then I had some other awards as well. So that's the Exceeding Expectations Award. And I had other awards along the way, all while working a full-time job, also running a business on the side, very profitable business on the side. So doing all that, but being very productive. Some other things. As part of the Maxwell team, I was added to the John Maxwell marketing team, as Derek mentioned earlier. So this was in 2021 is when I started with that team as a paid position on the faculty. I was also asked to join Joseph McLennan's neuro encoding organization to be a part of their marketing team to do some part-time work for them as well, as one of the instructors for that organization. And then with the Maxwell team, I was asked to also be a part of the mentorship team, which as you can see from this picture here, really, that's not a whole lot. So the John Maxwell team as a whole is roughly over 40,000 people worldwide. And so for the English faculty, I believe it's a little over 30,000 or so people. And so I was one of a handful of people that was asked to be a part of the mentorship for some special training that we did. It's all because I've proven time and time again that I can be productive in different areas where it matters. So that's kind of like what I'm going to share with you all today. All right. And so to help you get the most out of today's session, I told you I'm going to provide a handout at the end of it. But also, I want you to follow a simple philosophy that I learned from John Maxwell. It's called the ACT method. And it's a method that helps you take action as you're learning. And I'm a big believer of that, right? Learn a little bit, do a little bit. And so I believe this is going to help you out a whole lot. The A is for apply. So as we're going through this, and really all of the sessions today, you can use this method, right? Ask yourself, hey, how can I apply this to my life? There are going to be some things you're like, man, I'm not doing that right now. I need to apply that, right? So you can make a note on your paper. The C is for change. What do I need to change? Sometimes you see something like, man, I'm doing this. I need to turn this direction and go this way, change it. And then the last one is T for teach. So you may already be doing this, but you'll say, man, I'm doing this. It's working for me. Maybe I should share this with my club. Maybe I should share this with my family, right? So to whom can I teach this to? ACT. And I think if you're taking notes and you start going through this model, it'll help you retain information, but also be able to really use it, be able to really apply it to your life. And so we're talking about productivity today. So to get us started, I'm going to show you a short video from a guy that I learned a lot from. He passed earlier this year, but an amazing man, very influential in the personal development industry, Mr. Bob Proctor. So I'm going to show you a short video from Bob Proctor, and what he's going to talk about on this video really helped me out. And so I'll let you watch the video, and then I'll tell you how it helped me personally.
Hello there and welcome. I want you to think of one of the greatest deterrents to success. One of the greatest deterrents, one of the things that stops more people from enjoying the abundant life, the good life. I'll tell you what it is, it's procrastination. I have people coming to me almost in every seminar. They'll say, how do I overcome procrastination? I'm the worst at it. I got the things to do and I don't do them. I said, well, Napoleon Hill wrote an entire chapter in this book on the solution to procrastination. You know what it is? It's decision. Making a decision. You're not making a decision to do it. Listen to something he said here. He says, those who reach decisions promptly and definitely know what they want and they generally get it. The leaders in every walk of life decide quickly and firmly. That's a major reason why they're leaders. He said, the world is a habit of making room for the man or woman whose words and actions show that they know where they're going. Now, he said, indecision is a habit which usually begins in youth. The habit takes on permanency as the youth goes through grade school, high school, and then through college with no definiteness of purpose. He said, the major weakness of all educational systems is that they neither teach nor encourage the habit of definite decisions. I have told people in almost every seminar I go to, I have never made a decision for my kids. He said, well, you've got to make, no, I don't. Doesn't matter. When they were small, they'd come to me and they'd say, well, what do you think? I provoke them to think of what to do. See, they know what the right thing is to do. It's a matter of not making a decision. Now, start with little things. Little things you're putting off, do it. And do it right now. I know you've got other things. Do it. You see, decision is so important. When you make a decision to do something, you flip your brain onto the frequency that you have to be on to do it. You don't have to know how to do it. You only have to know you're going to do it. And when you make the decision, you'll flip your brain onto the frequency that it has to operate on, and you'll attract everything you need to execute that decision. Now, that may sound strange, but if you listen to this often enough, read the whole chapter in Think and Grow Rich on Decision. Read it every day for a month. I guarantee it'll change your life. And it's how you overcome procrastination. You don't have to suffer from procrastination for another day. Make a decision.
All right. So I absolutely love that little short video from Bob Proctor. And he is so right. Making a decision, just doing that, right? Make a decision right now that you're going to be more productive. It'll change everything. For me, it made all the difference in the world. You see, for years, I would procrastinate. I would constantly put things off or say, well, you know, I'll do it later. You know, I was kind of, I would hee and haw around. And I really wasn't getting things done. When I made a decision back in, it was probably about 2017, my wife and I made a decision to fix our finances. And that decision that we made, going through that process, really led us into a very great journey of being productive, right? Because we made a decision without compromise, and we kept following the steps along the way. And so that really opened up doors for it, changed everything, but it really changed our mindset more than anything else. And so today I'm going to talk about being more productive, and I'm going to use the word navigate as an acrostic to explain how you can be more productive. So, and I'm truly excited. So starting off, the letter N in navigate is all for now, right? So you have strategy number one is really developing a now mindset, really that do it now attitude. And that is so important. It really changes everything. And so before I even talk about what now is, let's talk about what the opposite of that is. The opposite of that is more procrastination, all right? And so procrastination is simply delaying or postponing or avoiding doing something that you know you should be doing. And let's face it, we all do it, right? We say, man, I'll do that later, or I know I need to work on this speech, but you wait. And then it never gets done. And then you start feeling all that pressure. I used to be there where I'd have all that pressure of, man, I said I would do that, but I'm not really prepared for it. But it's because of procrastination. So when you flip that switch and you have that more of that now mindset, you may not write your speech right at that moment, but hey, can you at least write a title for it or write an outline for it, right? Take the first step towards that now. Even if that now means I'm going to put a date on my calendar, say, okay, tonight at 6 p.m., I'm going to work on my speech. That's still you taking an action, a forward action versus waiting. So develop that now mindset. So here's one of the things I want you to do. This is all about activity, right? So write down on your piece of paper five things that you have delayed, postponed, or avoided doing that you know you should have been doing. You don't have to put it in the chat. Just write it down, because it's very important for you to understand, okay, there's things in your life that you're delaying, and there's probably a reason why. So think about five things right now that you're delaying. I'll give you a few seconds here. All right, so hopefully some things came to mind. Now you can ask yourself, okay, why did I delay that, right? And in some cases, it may not even be important to you, right? So maybe you can really scratch it off the list. But if it is important to you, then you gotta ask yourself, why? Why have I delayed doing the thing I know that I need to be doing? So hopefully you've all got your list. And so John Maxwell has an amazing quote. He says, the longer you wait to do something that you should do now, the less likely the chances are that you'll actually do it. Think about that. The longer you wait, the less likely the chances are that you'll actually do it. I'm guilty of that, right? I've tried to start exercise programs in the past, And I'll say, well, I'm going to wait. I'm going to put it off. You know, now the weather's not nice to go outside and exercise. Oh, it's cold in the basement. I don't want to go exercise there, right? So making all those excuses. The longer you wait, the less likely it is that you will ever do it. So you want to develop that do it now attitude. And John Maxwell, he was actually up in Dayton, Ohio many years ago, and he heard a gentleman speak by the name of W. Clement Stone. And W. Clement Stone gave John a formula for having a do it now mindset. And so his formula for John was simply to say do it now 50 times. This is what he said to the crowd. He said, you know, before you get out your bed in the morning, say, do it now, do it now, do it now, do it now, 50 times. And then you get up and go to action. He said, then before you go to bed, repeat yourself, do it now, do it now, do it now. And John said he started doing that. He said at first, he was kind of reluctant to doing it. Then he started doing it, became a habit. And he was like, he did it. And every time he said it, when any type of procrastination moment came up, he would hear in his head, do it now, and so he would quickly go do it, take action. And so that's part of developing that do it now mindset. All right. I hope you guys all got that. I'm showing you another short video about do it now, just to get you thinking about it a little bit more.
Now, a moment in time flanked by what was and what could be. Every now has the potential to be a punctuating moment in time. A kinetic explosion of what could be only comes when you take action in the now. We delay our now in the name of good timing or convenience, but they are thin veils for a deeper truth. We fear, so we stall.
I'll think about it more.
You'll do that 2 months from now.
Right. If I can postpone it, I can get ready.
Yet we only really get one now, which we sacrifice for later. No opportunity waits. Leap into your now.
All right, so one of the things I encourage you to do, that list of 5 things that you wrote down, I encourage you to kind of set a date of when you're gonna start that process, right? Whatever it was on that list, see if you can assign a date to it, because it'll help you with that do it now type of attitude. All right. So remember, strategy number one is all about having a now mindset. So moving on to strategy number two. Strategy number two is all about attitude. You know, your attitude is everything. So strategy two is all about developing that positive I can do it attitude. Because when you have that I can do it attitude, it helps open up doors for you. It'll change your perspective and help you be more productive. Right. That was one of the things that I heard from John Maxwell and people like Napoleon Hill year after year after year of studying their books and just learning from them. And I absolutely love it. Right? So just keep that in mind. You want to have that attitude is everything, that positive attitude. And I know for me, so when the pandemic started back in March 2020, my Toastmasters clubs, we never missed a meeting, right? Because I had already developed that can-do attitude. And I knew that, okay, when the pandemic was shut down, okay, I had a solution. We could use Zoom. So we started using Zoom. And then, of course, you know, I started helping the district set up things with Zoom. But it was because I already had that positive attitude, so I was able to continue to move forward, right? I didn't move in fear. I moved with positive expectations because my attitude was already there. And so that's going to help you out to be more productive. I mean, you start looking around at opportunities and what can I do? Asking those right questions to move yourself forward. All right, so that's all about developing an attitude. So I'm gonna share a short video from Bob Proctor talking about the importance of having a positive attitude.
You know, when an individual learns how to stay positive, everything in their life improves. Why is that? Well, if you're not positive, you're negative. If you're not going in one direction, you're going the other. Everything in this universe has an opposite. Ignorance, knowledge. That's the way it works. Up, down, hot, cold, positive, negative. How do you stay positive? Well, first of all, I think we want to understand that staying positive is staying in a vibration that's going to cause us to feel good, to do better, and to keep growing. It's not an accident.
We have a lady in our company who's our marketing director, Mikey Steller. She is one of the most positive. She has one of the best attitudes of anybody I've ever met. See, when a person's positive, they've got a good attitude. So how do we get there and stay there? We know we can get there by focus on something good. Well, just make up your mind that that's where you're going to stay. Now, it may take a while, but you can form the habit of staying positive. Mikey has. Does she go off track? Periodically. I've seen her when she's off track, but not very often. And when she gets off track like that, she comes back on track. You see, when you're not feeling good, you're not staying positive, you're focused on the negative. Look for what's good. Harvest the good. There's good in everything. Don't take any joy out of finding out what's wrong with something. Any dumbbell can point out what's wrong. It takes a respectable amount of intelligence and focus to figure out what's right. Now think of that. When you feel good, you're staying positive. When you don't feel good, you're negative. Feeling is conscious awareness of the vibration we're in. When you're positive, you're in a good vibration. When you're negative, you're in a bad vibration. When you're positive, you attract all kinds of good things to you. So you see, you can actually become a magnet for good by staying positive. It's a choice. And it's a choice you make.
Absolutely. Your attitude is a choice. So Napoleon Hill said it best. He said, a positive mental attitude is a must for all who wish to make life pay off on their own terms. Nothing great was ever achieved without a positive mental attitude. And your positive attitude will start attracting people. It'll attract opportunities to you, right? People want to be around people who are positive and upbeat. And your outlook and your productivity would definitely increase. So something to help you work on your positive attitude, I want you to do a little exercise here. So write down 5 things that you've acted on and produced a significant result in that you're proud of. Just write those on the paper. 5 things that you've done that you produced a result in that you're proud of, right? So you didn't procrastinate on these things. You did it. And it could be something simple, right? It could be, hey, I hit my water goal for this week. I hit my exercise goal for this week. But it's so important to take time out to celebrate ourselves, to pat ourselves on the back, to look at yourself in the mirror and to smile and say, I love you. Because it all works towards that attitude. All right, so while you guys are doing that, we'll move on. So that was strategy number 2. It's all about your attitude, developing that positive attitude. Moving on to strategy number 3 here, it's all about vision. So vision is so important, right? Our attitudes and beliefs create a magnet to attract events into our life. And so one of the things you want to do is make sure you have a crystal clear vision of what you're trying to accomplish, like your values and the things that are important to you. Have that clear vision, because it'll help you be more productive, because you're really going in the right direction. So something that helps me, I absolutely love vision boards. I know Phil Barth is on today. I remember I used to walk into, you know, before the pandemic, I would walk into Phil's office, and he always had a vision board up in his office. And he would also have things on his board, his whiteboard behind him. Things that he was working on to help him be more productive, right? It's important to have some type of vision in front of you that reminds you of what you're looking to accomplish. So here's an example of like a vision statement that I keep posted about my wife and I, right? So I have some things that I'm focused on with my training business, you know, our finances, our travel, like just different plans that we have, but we keep that in front of us to remind us on a regular basis. I mean, if you look at the wallpaper of my phone, I have the vision board right here on my phone. So I keep it in front of me on a regular basis to kind of keep me in that right direction of productivity. All right, so strategy number 3 was all about vision. Have a clear vision of what you're looking to accomplish. Moving on to strategy number 4. I learned this from John Maxwell, and it's all about intentionality. So John says that growth doesn't just happen, right? You have to be intentional about it. Your success isn't just going to happen. You have to be intentional. For me, even the success I've had with the John Maxwell team and with the Neuro-Coding Organization and other teams I've worked with, even in Toastmasters, right? It didn't just happen. I didn't just happen to win the Toastmaster of the Year in 2019, right? I had to be intentional about doing certain things. Now, my goal was never to win an award. My goal was to add value wherever I could, right? I was always intentional about adding value to whatever organization I'm a part of, being, making sure that I can add value and help them be better than what they are. That's always my goal. So that's an intentionality. And so I love how John says it, that growth doesn't just happen. And so another way to think of it is, you know, your success doesn't happen, isn't just going to happen. You have to be intentional. And that is so, so important, right? So that was that strategy, number four, intentionality. Moving on to strategy number five, it's all about goals. For me, I consider myself to be a true goal achiever, right? I don't like just setting random goals. I set goals with the intention of achieving them. I mean, because like this quote here says, I'm a firm believer that there's no point in setting a goal that you don't plan to achieve, right? It wastes your mental energy. I remember asking some people their goals and they'll say something wild. And I'm like, do you really even believe you're going to achieve that? No. Like, why would you even waste your mental, like, why even waste mental space on that goal if it's not something you're looking to achieve? Yeah, like, I love what Francisco said. You got to be a goal digger, right? Yeah, so just focus on, like, achieving those goals. That is so important. And me personally, I consider myself to be a goal nerd. Like, I love setting goals, but I'm big on making sure that you can achieve those goals, that I can achieve those goals. And you back those goals up with clear reasons why you want to achieve them, because it helps you be more productive, right? So if my goal is to get paid speaking gigs, right? So let's say that my goal is to be a professional speaker to get paid high-paid speaking gigs. So what I know I need to do, if that's my goal, then I have to ask myself, okay, what books should I be reading? What training should I be attending? Like, who should I be associating with? Because that's going to be putting me in that right direction of being productive. Because there's a lot of ways to waste your time, right? But if you're intentional and you're a goal achiever, you're going to keep moving in the right direction. So I'm going to show you a great video from Bob Proctor. And just so you know, so I intentionally are using Bob Proctor's video. So he passed, I think, maybe about a month or two ago. But Bob was very instrumental in my personal development many years ago. You know, I've never met him personally, but I absolutely loved his material. I used to listen to his audiobooks all the time. And so I'm going to show you a video with Bob talking about goal achievement.
Hello there and welcome. I want to talk to you about setting the right goals. A lot of people set the wrong goals. Why do we set goals? Well, most people say you set goals so you can earn more money, you can get ahead in life. That's not where you set goals at all. You set goals so you can grow. You see, you will not move ahead if you don't have a good reason to move ahead. That's the purpose of a goal. A goal is something you put out here that you really want to go after. You've got to really want it, and if you don't really want it, you won't go after it. You see, if you're going to grow, you're going to have to change habit patterns. You're going to have to shift paradigms. It's not an easy thing to do. I point out you're going to hit terror barriers. You're going to come up against things that just scare the daylights out of you if you're going to grow. If you're really going to grow everything into everything God meant you to be, you're God's highest form of creation. No one knows what you and I are capable of doing. Why would we ever think of staying where we are? We want to do better. We want to make it bigger. We want to run faster, jump higher. And we can if we have a goal. You see, the goal you set, you should know how to get there. If you know how to get there, it's the wrong goal. If you know how to get there, you've already been there, or at least you know how to do it. We call it ABC goals. A goal is doing what you already know how to do. B goal, doing what you think you can do. If I put this together, if I had this and that, and I got it all together, then this would happen. You know you can do it. The C goal That's where you're creating. You have no idea how you're going to get there. But because you can see it in your mind, you know you can hold it in your hand. Make certain that you set the right goal. And I guarantee you, you'll never have to worry about getting up in the morning. You won't have to worry about having a good day. You're going to be working toward your goal. I've got the most phenomenal goal. It gets me up early in the morning, keeps me going all day. You know something? I've already reached it in my mind. It's just a matter of time till it manifests. And that's the way you want to treat it. Now leave your information below. Click on the link and get into this. Set the right goal. You'll be glad you did.
All right. Yeah, absolutely love that video. And I see Scott said he searched on Bob. Yeah, Bob has great training for sure on his YouTube channel and other resources. So I'm just going to share with you all a goal that, that my wife and I achieved a few years back. So back in 2016, towards the end of 2016, we found ourselves $119,000 in debt. And we had no clue because prior to that point, you know, we were just like everybody else, right? We were just, you know, swiping here with our credit card, buying this, buying that. But we didn't have, we weren't really goal focused. So we had no clue where we were at. But the stress started building up. And so my wife and I, we signed up with Dave Ramsey's program, his Financial Peace University, 9-week program. And in that class, we started setting goals. We learned how to make a decision that we're going to get out of debt. We're going to focus and manage our money properly. And going through that process, because we were goal achievers, right, we had a plan in place. In 11 months, we paid off $119,000 of debt. And it opened up doors for us, of course, but it changed everything. And those habits that we learned through that program, we continued on forward, right? With things that I've done with Toastmasters and with the John Maxwell team and other organizations, even at work, right? Just helping me to be productive because I learned how to set goals and achieve them. So studying goal achievement is so important. It'll definitely open up doors for you and change a lot of things, especially with productivity. It makes it really easy for me to be productive now. And it also makes me really easy to be able to say no to things that don't line up with my goals. Even if they're things that are, you know, wonderful, right? Things that would be great, but I'm like, it doesn't line up with my goal right now. I just can't dedicate the time to it. But if it does line up with my goal, it's an easy yes for me. And I'm able to continue to move forward in productivity. So then moving on, the next strategy is A. It's all about accountability. And I love this quote here. It says, it is not only what we do, but also what we do not do for which we're accountable, right? So just think about that, right? It's great for things that you do, but there's also things that we're supposed to do that we don't do, that we're going to be accountable for. For me, having an accountability partner or accountability people in my life, it's been so instrumental towards my success. Because being accountable, you know, if you know you've got to report to your mentor or your coach or even your spouse, right, about something, you got to be accountable to them, you're more likely to do it. You know, if I tell my health coach that, hey, I'm going to work out X number of times, and I know that, hey, my phone call is coming up with them, then I'm going to do whatever I can to make sure that I hit those goals. So that way I don't have to get on the call and make excuses, right? I can say, yes, I did that. I did that. I didn't do it as best as I could, but I still did it. But it's all about accountability. And so if your goals matter to you, then accountability should matter too. You know, you want to try to, for me personally, I've learned to try to avoid that Superman syndrome where I'm trying to do it all by myself. And for me, that really can be easy to do. I'm a natural introvert. Right? I thrive sometimes in isolation. However, I've learned that in isolation, I get a lot less done. So I have to stretch myself and be accountable to somebody and say, hey, this is what my goals were. This is what I've done. This is what I didn't do. Right? And then work for that. But it being accountable changes a lot of things for you. So if you are working with an accountability partner, let me give you a couple of different things that questions you can ask them, right? So here's three, you can tell them, you know, your wins. Share your wins with your accountability partner. Now, here's three things that went really well last week. Right? You can also share what you're proud of, or if you did anything new or something surprising that happened. You can also share your losses with your accountability partner. You know, what didn't go well? Where did you drop the ball? You know, what goals did you fail to achieve? Let's face it, we've all been there, right? You can also let them know about your fixes. You know, how will you correct the problems this new week that maybe you couldn't do last week? Right? Maybe you set a goal to exercise a certain number of days and you didn't hit it. Or, you know, if your accountability partner, you think into it and you say, well, okay, maybe I should dress the part and I'm more likely to exercise. Or maybe I should put it on my calendar when the alarm goes off and go exercise at that point. You can also let your accountability know what your next goals are for the next week, maybe your top three goals for your next week. But just having an accountability partner will help you out so much. All right. So then moving on, our next strategy is all about trade-offs. And John Maxwell says in in several of his books, you have to give up to grow up. And so really what that means, what are you willing to trade in order to be more productive, right? So think to yourself, okay, what am I willing to trade in 2022 to ensure a more productive year? I know for me, especially during the pandemic, I had to trade off watching too much television, right? Because it's easy to do, especially working from home. You got access to more things, but I had to trade that off for more study time. And so when it comes to productivity and thinking about trade-offs, things that you're willing to let go of, be willing to give up maybe financial security today for more potential tomorrow. Be willing to give up immediate gratification for personal growth. Be willing to give up the fast life for the good life. You can be willing to give up security for significance. Be willing to give up addition for multiplication. Be willing to trade entertainment for goal achievement. And then be willing to trade good taste for good health, right? There's certain little trade-offs that we're going to have to make to be more productive. So start thinking about, you know, with that list of five things that you put on your paper, think about, okay, what do I need to trade off or give up or let go of to be able to do this? And I guarantee you, if you start asking yourself those type of questions, ideas will start forming, right? When you go do a Google search, you'll have an idea what to search for based on the questions that you're asking yourself. And it'll help you find those answers for sure. All right, so then moving on. So in using the word navigate, the next letter is E. It's all about execution. And I love what Seth says here. There's no shortage of remarkable ideas. What's missing is the will to execute them. So no shortage of remarkable ideas. What's missing is the will to execute them. Let's face it. I guarantee you that if I said I would pay you $1,000 to tell me how someone could lose 10 pounds over the next 6 months, I guarantee you everyone on here could tell me, right? You all have a proven plan because they all exist. Somewhere, right? We all know what to do. That's easy. But what stops us a lot of times is that failure to execute the plan. And I told you before about my wife and I's debt-free journey. And we did it. We made a conscious decision as a couple. We said, hey, we're going to execute the plan that's been given to us no matter what. No compromise. We're not going to fuss about it, right? We're going to execute that plan. We were in agreement and we did it. And the same for you with your productivity. So whatever the thing is you're trying to accomplish, the area you're trying to be more productive in, you have to execute the plan. The plan is all around us, right? It's very rare that we have an idea that hasn't already been solved by somebody. Maybe 1% of the population has ideas like that, but for most of us, our ideas are general, right? How do I get in better shape? How do I become, you know, higher paid speaker? How do I get a promotion on my job, right? There's books and there's trainings that have all been written on all that stuff. There's plans in place that people have, ideas that people have. We just have to execute that plan without compromise. And I truly believe that if you do that, it'll help you out. Right? So, because let's face it, sometimes it's hard for people to execute that plan. So here's some things to think about here, right? So when it comes to setting goals, your goal needs to be as specific as possible. Your goal has to be measurable. Your goal has to be your goal. It can't be other people's goals, right? You know, I can't hear Derek's goal and say, oh yeah, you know, Derek's goal is that, so maybe that should be my goal too, right? It's not gonna work that way because I'm not gonna have the same type of motivation if it's not my goal. Your goals need to be written down. There's so much science behind the power of writing. You know, one of my mentors, Joseph McClendon, he says, what you write, you invite. It's not typing, right? So what you actually write, you invite, because there's something in your brain when you actually write something down. That's why journaling is so important. When you think about your goals, you want to identify a plan that you're going to use to achieve that goal and be flexible, right? You can be flexible with your plan. Your plan may need to be tweaked along the way. And that's when having an accountability partner is going to help out. And then, like I said before, commit to a plan without compromise. And just run as hard as you can towards that. And friends, I truly believe that if you take these steps along the way, you would definitely have a more productive year. So just to recap, N is for now, do it now. A is for attitude, develop a positive attitude. V is all about vision. Create a vision board or some type of vision for your life. I, choose to be intentional. G, become a goal achiever, not just a setter, but a goal achiever. A is all about accountability, so get an accountability partner. T, determine what you will trade off. And E, execute your plan without compromise. And I truly believe if you follow those steps, you will have a more productive 2022 and beyond. And Derek, I will turn it back over to you. I'll put the handout in the chat for everybody as well. But it's been my honor to serve District 40 once again. I appreciate you all. Derek, back to you, sir.
Thank you, Michael. What a great presentation. I was busy taking notes all the way throughout. I'm thinking of all the people that I'm mentoring this year, some of these goals that we can help set for each other and hold each other accountable. So I truly appreciate the presentation today.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
I'm going to drop the link for the evaluation into the chat. Please make sure to provide an evaluation for all of our presenters today, especially for this presentation from Michael, so that our presenters are always striving to do better. As Toastmasters, we always look to see what we can do to make our presentations better. So please make sure you fill out your evaluations to encourage our Toastmasters and presenters on to greater and better things. Again, thank you, Michael. Does anyone have any questions? We have a couple of minutes left.
Yeah, if anybody has any questions, feel free to reach out to me, either social media, email, or right here, we can ask, I'll take any questions. Hey, Todd.
Michael, can you just review the trade-offs real quick? I just wasn't as fast note-taking that part.
Oh, yeah. So the trade-offs that I had, and these were just examples, but my trade-offs, let me go back to it real quick.
I like those.
I said, be willing to give up financial security today for potential tomorrow. And actually, let me just put them in the chat real quick. Let me do that.
Oh, that'd be perfect.
Let's see. So let me, it didn't copy quite right, but you might be able to make it out. It didn't copy the bullet points, of course, but yeah. See if that works for you, Todd.
I don't think I'm looking now. Maybe it has it, wait. No, I don't think that's the same one.
Oh, that wasn't trade-offs. Okay, sorry. Let me go. Oh, yeah, you're right.
Still good stuff.
Let's try this one then. All right, there you go.
Ah, that's it. Thank you. All right.
Great question. You're welcome. And Patty, I know you asked about the John Maxwell team, so I can give you more information on that. I know the price ranges for joining the John Maxwell team, but I could definitely get you in contact with one of the coordinators if you'd like more information on it. And they do give you discounts if you go through somebody else, right? So if I'm your referral, you'll get a discount. I get a referral or whatever as well.
How long does it take you to get your money back?
I'll say again.
The money that you put into the training with John Maxwell, how long did it take you to make the money back?
So for me, I probably, for me personally, my path is a little different, but probably about 4 or 5 months. But I kind of, so my case is unusual, right? So I'm on the faculty for John Maxwell, which is a paid position. And I've got other perks and financial things because of that too. But that's not the norm. But I don't do things the normal way. But yeah, but you can, and it's going to vary, right? I know coaches who, with the Maxwell team, who have probably never made a dime, right? They signed up and they're probably never will make any money as a coach or a speaker. Right. It's just like people that have been in Toastmasters for over a decade and they haven't completed 10 speeches yet. Right. It's like people, it depends on their goals. Yeah. But it is an amazing organization. And I was able to go there because of what I learned in Toastmasters. Right. I started doing training sessions here in Toastmasters first before I was ever able to go charge for presentations.
It was interesting learning that you're a natural introvert and now seeing you do all these presentations and trainings. Does that natural introvert still come back from time to time?
Oh, absolutely. But I made a decision, and Toastmasters helped with that, right? Because when I joined Toastmasters, I was terrified of public speaking. But just being in the Toastmasters meeting other people and realizing that your audience wants you to succeed, right? They're applauding you on and all that. I mean, so yeah, it helps. I'm still an introvert, but I'm intentional about my goals. So I'm willing to meet people. I'm willing to step outside my comfort zone whenever I can.
Awesome. Thanks. We're about to get kicked out of the breakout room.
And Sarah, send me a message that I can get you a link to that video.
Thanks again, Michael. We're about to get kicked out of the breakout room.
You're welcome.